So yeah, my name is Jake, and we're going to talk about smart contracts, and in particular, how to sort of detect what Etherscan calls internal transactions. This is a notoriously hard sort of thing to do, and we've heard from lots of people that it's challenging, so we just wanted to kind of present our experiences with it, issues we've seen, and how to sort of handle these safely, and how to prevent you from having similar sorts of problems in the future. Like you said, I'm on the cryptocurrency team at Coinbase. We are the team that runs our blockchain integrations for all the currencies, hot wallet, cold storage, sends, receives. We're hiring, if that's interesting to you. Just come talk to me afterwards. We'll get started, though. And so who should care about this stuff? These are kind of the primary three we see here is like exchanges, wallets, and explorers. The highest risk comes to exchanges, which we'll talk about. But really, it matters for everybody and anybody building on Ethereum. And the reason is because if you're sort of accepting deposits of any sorts of Ethereum, there's different ways it can happen. And so your primary responsibility is to take a transaction and sort of turn that into a set of debits and credits to accounts or to update balances or whatever you're trying to do here. And so if we take a transaction like this, we're going to go here and inspect it and say, okay, we should credit Alice 1 ETH, and we do that. But the risk here is, what if that's not actually what happened? Right? What if we shouldn't have credited Alice's ETH and there's some sort of bug in our code? This is what comes up with contracts, because it's not a straightforward thing to do, and there's a lot of nuance to how to handle it. And so what this can lead to is a couple of different things. Invalid data is sort of the first one here, right? Just having bad data, showing a wrong account balance is not ideal. It's not the worst, but it can lead to pretty bad experiences. If somebody thinks they have 10 ETH, then they try and send that, and then it just consistently fails, they might switch to a different wallet. And if you have systems building on top of this, if it's some sort of API and you have downstream customers, then they're going to get bad data and they're going to have to update accordingly their database, and that's going to be pretty challenging, and there's not really good ways to handle that. So you want to avoid this sort of as much as you can. And like I said, the real risk is actually to exchanges here with lost funds, because what they can do is this type of attack where you send in Ether, but you don't really, it just kind of looks like it. You can trick the system. And then they can sell that for some other currency and send it off somewhere else. Or they can just send off Ether. And in exchanges cases, a lot of them have pooled wallets where everybody's funds are together. So if you send in and you send back out, it's probably not going to be the same Ether. It's going to be something different. And so you can actually just steal Ethereum that way and continue this until you're caught. And so if you have these types of mistakes, this is the types of headlines you might see written about you. It's not good. If you see HackerOne reports like this, you also don't want to see these kinds of things. And this is what we sort of saw at some point earlier in the year. And yeah, you don't want that. And so what can go wrong here? How do we fix it? To start that, we need to talk about how Ethereum moves. So as I'm sure most of us are familiar with, everything happens in a block. Then you have a set of transactions. And in those transactions, Ethereum can move. But within the transaction, it's not just one way. You sort of have two different types here. You've got what we can call account transfers. It's just a standard transaction sending from one account to another. And you can also have this other bucket here, which is like contracts. And contracts can do pretty clever things, which we'll talk about here. But the account transfers, like I said, are pretty straightforward. This is what you'll see on Etherscan, and this is kind of what you'll get back from your node if you're just asking, hey, give me a transaction. It's going to look a lot like this, and calculating how much value went to where. There's a from, there's a to. All that's pretty easy to do, and there's not really much risk here. If it says a transaction happened in this format, it did, and you're pretty good to go. But where it gets complicated is contract transfers. They might look like this. So now instead of just sending to one user, you can send to sort of N amounts of accounts, and it scales up. And what's really sort of difficult about these is that this is custom code people write. So they have a lot of room outside of just what the protocol allows to trick you and to specifically target issues in your system and hack you because of it. And so there's not a great APIs for this. What you have to use is this API called the tracing API, which is fairly low level and not that easy to parse. And it looks a bit like this. You're not gonna be able to read it, but it's pretty complicated. And this is actually a simple one. This is basically like one of those sends where I showed like 10 in the previous slide. So it gets more complicated. There's a lot of nuance here. But if we started to think about inspecting these and seeing what it looks like, if you zoom in, you'll see there's a from and a gas and a to, similar to a transaction. But if you were to take it and just treat this as such, you'd be in for not a good time. And so we'll go over a few examples of here, different types of problems that can happen and the right ways to sort of handle those. And so on this left side, we have what we're going to call traces here. There's different types of calls. And we see one, we send Alice 1 ETH, another to Bob. And if we just turn that into credits and debits accordingly, we would do that. And the issue here is, like I presented earlier, it doesn't actually happen that way in this transaction. And it's because we're missing something. So not everything's going to be on the slides here, and we're going to sort of bring those in over time. And so in this case, what you actually need to look at is this thing called the transaction status, which we'll see here. So this came with an upgrade, I believe last year, I think, of the Byzantium upgrade. They added this new opcode, and they also added the status to this thing called a transaction receipt. And so when a transaction is included in a block, the blockchain will generate this thing called a receipt, which tells you, it's similar to like a store receipt. It's just, you know, here's the final state of what happened. And so if you didn't use all the gas or it failed for some reason, that kind of information will be there. And so in this case, we see that the receipt is a failure. And so what that means is actually none of the transfers that we might have that might have happened if it didn't fail can actually happen or didn't happen. And so accounting for that in this example, we see here that nobody received any and we're good to go. So for example two, this is the same sort of scenario here, except we do see this thing that says fail on one of these calls. And I didn't really describe the calls yet, but a call is just this sort of, it's this type of a trace. There's different, a few different types. And so these sends are also calls, but these ones are other ones that may just like call some function to, you know, log something or to, that doesn't actually transfer anything anywhere. It's just, you know, calling a contract. And so generally, you know, you might ignore these if you just care about sort of your customer's information. And so, learning what we just learned, we do check the transaction receipt status when we try and parse this, and we see it's a success, so we credit Alice and Bob. And if you sort of caught on from the previous example, it didn't actually happen. But what's interesting about this scenario is it's not that nobody received any, it's that only some did. So this transaction receipt status doesn't tell you everything. There's this possibility of like a full failure where the transaction receipt is a failure, but there's this partial failure states as well, and these can get more complicated than this. And so in this example, what we really need to do when we're looking at these traces is turn it into a tree. So it's actually, if we can see this like hierarchy here, we have this call at the root, and then we have, you know, Alice receives one, and then a few nested calls, and then one of them is a failure. And what this looks like in the trace is there's this thing called, there's an error on it, and if it has an error, that means it failed. And so when you put it into this tree format, you can see that the send to Bob is actually within that part of the tree. And when it's there, what that means is that that doesn't actually happen and you shouldn't create any credits or debits. And so accounting for that, we give Alice the one ETH and we're good to go. So the last example here looks entirely the same as the former one. So there's even more here to kind of look at. And so in this example, if we did the same thing, we credit Alice, and then that's wrong. And in this time, nobody should receive anything. And so there's another thing missing here. So when we look at these calls, there's different types of calls. There's not just one. There's all sorts of different ones. But in particular, in this example, I'm using one called a delegate call. So we need to pick out the specific types of calls that can actually transfer Ethereum around and sort of either ignore the other ones or treat them differently. And so in this case, a delegate call, without going into sort of details of what exactly it does, it looks identical to just sending Ethereum somewhere, except it doesn't actually do that. And so in this example, when we account for that, we do see that nothing happens. So that was a little bit about like how to handle these. And it's a tricky thing, and it could get more complicated in the future. That's like it today, but a lot of really clever things are happening, a lot of cool stuff people want to work on. And it's really hard to get this right. And these things aren't that documented either. And so we got to figure out a way that even if we don't know the answer, how do we sort of make sure we're not exposing ourselves to these issues? Because if you've been in many of the talks today, so many of them are based around contracts, right? Identity and all sorts of things are just contracts sending everywhere. And so you have to be able to support these, but many exchanges or many wallets don't because of the complexity around this and because of the risk in particular to exchanges of getting like hacked and actually losing money. And so the kind of answer here is this type of sort of detection and response. And the first step of that is just acknowledging that you don't know everything. Things are going to change, and especially if you're working with multiple blockchains and multiple currencies, that kind of stuff, it's just some of it's going to slip by. Some little note in a release notes of some upgrade of your software is going to change something, and you may not realize it. And so you just want to take a step back and say, you know, I might not know everything. And if you don't, well, like, how do you do this? Like, how do you make an answer here? And so one way to do this is sort of cross-check your data, right? There's a lot of people building, there's a lot of people you can talk to about this, but really if you can automate this, that's sort of the ideal here. If you can cross-check your data and say, oh, well, I think this happened, and then this other thing says it doesn't, and it's a source you trust, then maybe you shouldn't do that. And so what you should do there is actually like fail securely. So rather than failing like open and letting some sort of payment go through and you know credit an account and allow that to be hacked, just set it aside. Like put it in a queue, alert somebody on your team. They can investigate it and see what's going on. And then they can determine if it's actually a bug or if it's not. And so this is the kind of stuff we've done now. And it's actually really helpful even outside of this. Like since we've implemented, we actually haven't seen anything like this. But what we have seen is just little things being off here and there. You know, some calculation of a balance is slightly wrong, or some type of send we didn't, or some type of receive we didn't support. And it's just like, oh, it's off. And it's like, cool, it's like this alert just that something's wrong, and we get to go in and fix it and figure out why and improve our systems without ever affecting any of our customers, which is even better that you get alerted of things that are wrong, and you're just like, oh, cool, I can fix that. And so we'll kind of put things into takeaways here and sort of sum all this up. So the first step is check the receipt status. It's easy to check. There's APIs for this. It's a Boolean field. You know, it's true or false, basically. It's numbers. But so just check that. And if it says it failed, then none of the transfers happened. The nuance here is, like, you do still pay for the gas here. Like, failed transactions are still included in blocks because somebody had to execute it. All the miners and nodes need to execute the transaction to the failure to validate it. So it still costs, like, resources. So even though it failed, you still need to check it, and they still do actually pay the gas for it. But none of the transfers. And the second one here is to parse the trace as the tree. There's information in the way the trace is formatted, and the traces I sort of showed here that I'm describing are parodies. Geth has a tracing API like this too now, but they're not the same. It's not a standardized thing, and so you need to reference sort of Geth's documentation for how it works there. I imagine it's similar, but you need to take this flat list they provide you and sort of structure it into some sort of tree, and then once you do that, you can inspect these sort of errored subtrees and either like filter them out or mark them failed or you know whatever you want to do there. Thirdly, we want to reject these like delegate and call code calls. These are two different types of ones that kind of look like they're transferring things, but they actually don't. And then if you kind of take the earlier point about failing safely here, what you really should do here is actually just select the ones you know do it. So this is similar. If there's an upgrade you don't know about, if there's some sort of change, at least you know these ones work. I didn't mention these other ones, but these are like creators for creating contracts, self-destruct for destroying one, and rewards for like block awards. These are the kind of things that can, you know, credit ETH in like other ways or like send it. And so if you select those and handle those cases appropriately, you know you're sort of at least reasonably safe. And then if you implement this next point of don't trust until verified, right? Verify your data, check with other sources. You don't have to like trust it completely, but at least it's sort of a signal that something's wrong, right? Don't just take that and write it to your database and be like, that's the truth. But what you should do is at least look at it and be like, all right, something's weird here. And also if you're getting a lot of false positives, you know, maybe pick some other source. And yeah, that's it for today. So I hope you all stay safe out there and hope everybody, we learned something here. And we've got, I think, some time for questions about 4Mentors, so if you have any.